Here's a quick tutorial on how to do hypothesis testing when you're dealing with proportions, specifically with one proportion. I'm going to do this using both the classical method and the p-value method. So we go through and read this. What we're given is that 70% of the population, something that will always be true. In this case, it's our board by this video, but whatever, it doesn't matter what it is. The key here is that this is about the population. This is about everybody. So we're going to use the symbol p not for this. We've been using p in the past for it, but we want to use p for something else here, so we're going to call it p not. And a sample of, so that'll be key. You'll always be given population stuff and sample stuff. In a sample of 80 statistics students who watched this video, only 50 were bored by it. Your calculator uses x and n for these two things. This is the number of people in your sample, and this is the number of people that fit this criteria in that sample. And we want our conclusion to have 95% level of confidence. In other words, alpha is equal to 0.05. So if you go through and do this problem, the way I'm going to always do these problems, we're going to start out by stating the null and the alternative hypotheses. The null hypothesis will always be P relative to P naught. So in this case, P naught is equal to 70%, so I'll put 0.70 here. But both the null and alternative hypotheses will always be P relative to P naught. And the null will always be P equals P naught. Whereas the alternative, you'll have to read the problem to figure out. In this case, it says, makes the video less boring. So we have less than here. So what really we have here is a left-tailed test. And again, it's because being in a statistics class makes this less boring. This P here is a population proportion. But specifically, it's a population proportion if the entire population were in a statistics class. So it's easy to confuse this with a sample proportion, p hat, which I guess I can write that off to the side, p hat, which is x over n, in this case, 5/8, 50 over 80. This is similar to that, except this is population and this is sample. Anyways, that'll always be the first step. Second step for us will be to state the shape, the center, and the spread, so that we can later draw a picture, center and spread. The shape is going to be approximately normal. That's what it always is in this class. The reason why it's approximately normal is the criteria we saw earlier was n times p times 1 minus p had to be greater than or equal to 10. That's not what it is here because we don't know what p is. However, we do know P naught. We're going to assume our null hypothesis is that P equals P naught. So we can just use P naught down here. So really what we can do is say N is 80. P naught is 0.70. 1 minus P naught is I'll write 1 minus 0.70. It's 0.30. And if you do that multiplication, I do it in my head, you get 80 times 0.7 times 0.3. This is 0.3 in here. You get 16.8. I might have said that or close. I don't know. Anyways, 16.8. Sure enough, that's greater than or equal to 10. Awesome. Our shape's approximately normal. Center. We would like P to be the center. However, we don't know P, but our null hypothesis assumes that P equals P naught. So we'll use P naught for the center, which is 0.70. And our spread, sigma sub, P hat is the symbol, but not a big deal that you know this symbol, is, we have a formula for that. It's the square root of, see, in the past it was P times 1 minus P over N. That's not what it's going to be here because, as I said, we don't know P. But we assume P equals P naught. We assume our null hypothesis is true. So we can make those P naughts. And then you can calculate this if you really want to. Sure, why not? 0.7 times 0.3 divided by, what was N, 80? But that's not my spread. I need to take the square root of that. So I'll hit square root of answer, and I get 0.05-ish. I don't know, 0.51, good enough. So I have the shape, the center, and the spread. So now I can draw pictures and make my conclusion. Turns out that I'm going to draw different pictures depending on which method of testing I'm using. If I'm using the classical method, I'm going to draw a picture over here. And if I'm using the p-value method, I'll draw a picture over here. Either way, I want something that's approximately normal. There's a couple distributions that are supposed to be approximately normal. Either way, I want the center to be 0.70. Okay, now I'll just deal with the classical for a minute. If we're going to do this the classical way, what I got to do is set up my rejection regions. I know this is a left-tailed test and that alpha is equal to 0.05, so I want a rejection region over here on the left-hand side equal to 0.05. And I can figure that out. I can use the inverse norm function on my calculator, and that'll give me the z-score that has 0.05 below it. So if I hit second and then distributions, then go down to inverse norm and put in 0.05. You don't have to put in (0, 1). I do it just to be really clear that what I'm getting here, this -1.645, is really a z-score, which is why I write it down on a different row here. Z-score has a center of 0, and this value goes here. And so now what I want to do is figure out my test statistic, and if my test statistic is in the rejection region, if it's less than -1.645, I'll reject the null hypothesis. And what's nice is my calculator has a function that'll calculate the test statistic for me. It's under tests. It's this fifth guy here, 1 prop z test. Prop standing for proportion, 1 because we only have one proportion, z test. Proportions are always z test. It's because we're only estimating one parameter, p. We're not estimating two parameters, like, for example, sigma and mu. Anyways, it's a 1 prop z test, and we have all the information. We know that p0 was 0.70, x was 50, and n was 80. And our alternative hypothesis is that p is less than p0. So it's the second guy here. And so now if I hit calculate, I get a test statistic of -1.46. Close. I wonder if I can move this over a little bit. What was the last thing I typed here? Yeah. I'm just going to slide this over a little bit so I have a little bit more room to write here. There's that -1.645 for my critical value. My test statistic is -1.5. I'm not going to carry very many decimal places because I don't have a whole lot of room for it. My test statistic, which corresponded with the 50 divided by 80 with p hat, 5/8, which is 0.625. I'll just write 50 over 80 here so it's more apparent what it came from. That test statistic is only over here. It's not in my rejection region. So what I would say is because my test statistic which in this case was -1.5, is not in the rejection region. There is not sufficient evidence. To reject the null hypothesis. I'm not saying the null hypothesis is true. I'm just saying there's not enough evidence to conclude that it's false. So my test statistic's not in the rejection region. There's not enough evidence to conclude that it's false. And that's the end of the problem if you were using the classical method. If you're using the p-value method, so now we're going to jump back, pretend you had done all of this green work, and then you come down here to draw the picture. It's a slightly different picture if you're using the p-value method. It turns out it's a little easier. You put the exact same thing into your calculator. But now what you get is your test statistic is the you don't set up rejection regions is in short what you do. You still get your test statistic is -1.5. And that still corresponds with the p hat, which is 50 over 80. Somewhere over here, exact same thing I did here. But now I don't make rejection regions. All I say is that my p-value, which since this is a left-tailed test, it's the area to the left that I'm trying to shade in here, although I didn't do a great job of it. Whatever, I'm sure you don't care. Is, and then it's this value right here, this 0.07. This can get really confusing, 0.072, because you have p hat and p here. They look very similar. They're not at all related. P hat, the 0.625, is this fraction, 50 over 80. P is a probability. It's the probability of getting a result this extreme. So it's the value below here. But anyways, the 0.072 is what we need here. So when we're drawing our conclusion, we would say because my p-value, which in this case was 0.072, is greater than alpha. Maybe I can do that. Because the p-value is greater than alpha, there is not sufficient evidence to reject the null hypothesis. So p-value, here's your picture, here's your conclusion. Classical, here's your picture, here's your conclusion. Key thing to know is that you'll always get the same conclusion. So there's the two different methods dealing with a one proportion z-test.